cacti, jojoba, ocotillo, rattlesnakes, scorpions. This was my stereotype of southern Arizona. It's all desert. Yet, beyond the Sonoran Desert here, there are a multitude of landscapes offering a variety of species. Southeast Arizona, the Sky Islands, is not just a desert. Within the vast Madrean archipelago lies a special subregion, in some ways its very core, consisting of the Patagonia Mountains, the San Rafael grasslands, and Sonoyta Creek. Join me for a naturalist saunter into the very heart of the Sky Islands region to explore its fascinating biodiversity, its flora and fauna, as well as some of the threats looming to its continued existence. The rolling plains of the San Rafael, this virtual sea of grass, are an excellent vantage point from which to see some of the 43 Sky Islands that constitute the Madrean Archipelago. And you might be surprised to learn that this is the most biologically rich area in all of North America. The sweeping San Rafael grasslands support the world's second fastest land mammal, the pronghorn, which can reach speeds of over 50 miles per hour, eluding most predators. The males shed their horns each year, the only animal on Earth to do so. Although superficially resembling the antelopes of the Old World, the closest living relatives of the pronghorn are actually the giraffe and its cousin, the odd okapi of Africa. It is the sole surviving species from the Pleistocene era, thousands of years ago. One other mammal that might occasionally give pronghorn a run for their money are antelope jackrabbits. These large hares, which may reach 10 pounds in weight, can attain speeds of 40 miles per hour and cover 20 feet in larger strides, traits that help them avoid coyotes, golden eagles, and other predators. Of all the habitats found in the Patagonia Mountains and the Sky Islands region at large, none are more rare or valuable than those containing water. This stretch of Harshaw Creek is a perfect example of just how crucial a link these habitats are in our fragile web of biodiversity. Harshaw Creek cuts a beautiful path deep here in the Patagonia Mountains. It looks like nature's aquarium. It's clear, the sound is beautiful by these little falls here. But water quality, or lack thereof, will determine if indeed it harbors life. Let's go take a look with my dip net and see if we can find anything living in here. That will be the report card as to the health of this beautiful little stream. We have a water boatman here, which is a true bug in the order Hemiptera. Some of its cousins, water scorpions. We have a few fish in here. And that is indeed a rare find in Harshaw Creek. These look like young longfin dace, one of the native species of southern Arizona. Anurans, the amphibian taxonomic group that includes frogs and toads, are well represented in the Sky Islands. Even this small stream supports at least one species that can be quite difficult to find, owing to its superb camouflage, the Kangen tree frog. This tiny frog has suction cup toes that allow it to cling to even vertical surfaces. It relies on water for its breeding cycle, with females depositing eggs in the creek. Given its total dependence upon water as a species and its highly permeable skin, you might call the Kangen tree frog a proverbial canary in a coal mine, a good barometer of water quality. Within the greater Sky Islands region, and certainly here in the Patagonia Mountains, we have certain pillars of biodiversity, species that help support other species. And one of them is right here, southwestern black or Gooding's willow. In late winter and spring, the non-showy but very important flowers full of nectar and pollen help support a host of butterflies. When it leaves out, tent caterpillars start to eat the leaves and in turn feed species like yellow-billed cuckoos, which are in danger, and other birds. Many people are surprised to learn that Arizona hosts a few jaguars, the world's third largest cat species on average after old world tigers and lions. Today, we're relegated to a few lone males. Jaguars tend to gravitate towards watery environments like those at Harshaw Creek. which in turn supports many other species. They also need robust prey populations like healthy herds of white-tailed deer, mule deer, and collared peccary. So if you protect jaguar, you tend to offer umbrella protection for those and other species as well. As if one neotropical cat wasn't enough to make the Sky Islands a special place, we also provide habitat to a much smaller species, the ocelot. Historically even rarer than the jaguar in Arizona, this bobcat-sized predator continues to periodically surface north of the U.S.-Mexico border. A huge Arizona sycamore here in Upper Harshaw Creek, seemingly a universe unto itself and a hub of life. It has its feet wet, even though we can't see water here. Certainly the aquifer is quite high to support such a giant. And judging by the size of this particular sycamore, with about 7 major trunks, I would estimate this is centuries old. Up in its limbs, I see red-naped sapsucker holes, holes from woodpeckers where they nest, and natural cavities that support elegant trogon breeding pairs. Several small species of owl, whiskered screech owls, the world's tiniest owl species, the migratory elf owl. Meanwhile, the small northern pygmy owl often tackles much larger vertebrate prey, including quail and jays. The king of the owls and the largest species in the Sky Islands is the great horned. This silent hunter brings death to a wide assortment of prey, including skunks, of which we have 4 species in the region, and even huge Mexican wild turkeys weighing over 20 pounds. Clark's spiny lizard, a large species that feeds upon invertebrates, also lurks within various holes. No more fierce a hunter stalks these woodlands than the greater roadrunner. This strange ground-dwelling member of the cuckoo family doesn't consume seeds, but rather a wide array of other animals. One of the more formidable species inhabiting the San Rafael is no bigger than my pinky nail. The red harvester ant resides in an underground colony that may exceed 10,000 individuals. Several predators have largely managed to circumvent the fierce defenses of the ants, turning them into highly prized food. Perhaps the species best suited to consume the harvester ants is the odd regal horn lizard. Thick saliva so effectively coats the ants that their stings are rendered ineffective. Various hawks, like northern harriers, falcons, snakes, and other mammals, would like nothing better than to add a fat horned lizard to their daily menu. I'm pushing my way through perhaps the most unique habitat in all the Sky Islands, a cienega. It's a strange word that means a marshy or swampy area. And as you might imagine, that's quite rare in arid Arizona. They used to be more common until water tables dropped due to human use. But here is this one, right near Sonora Creek, and it's full of life. I just pushed my way through veritable prison bars of velvet ash, one of the key species here, and a tree that can survive inundation of water with its roots. Most other trees would die. So if it looks like another state, it doesn't look like Arizona. I agree with you. Greyhawks are one of the many raptor species that call the Sky Islands home, and each year they'll come back to raise a brood. One of the most important riparian trees growing near and along Sonora Creek is netleaf hackberry, named for its fine network of veins on the underside of the leaf. The fruits supporting birds and mammals, including troops of white-nosed coatis. One of the most iconic Sky Island scenes is that of a troop of white-nosed coatis busily traveling through or foraging in various habitats. In particular, they're drawn towards riparian forests, replete with the resources they need to survive. The U.S. portion of the Madrean Archipelago hosts more biodiversity than any comparable area in North America. Traveling up from the region's valleys to a mountaintop, we encounter a great number of habitats, including Sonoran Desert, Chihuahuan Desert, riparian forests, arroyo scrub and woodlands, swamps, grasslands, savannas, Madrean evergreen woodland, pine forest, spruce fir forest, montane meadows, aspen forest, and various burned habitats. We have the most mammal species in North America north of Mexico, 108. Over 500 species of birds have been documented here, including the most sparrow species on Earth, 35. 18 species of hummingbirds, the most of any U.S. state. The highest density of breeding raptors, hawks and owls, on the planet. The Sky Islands host the most reptile species in North America, 80. Over 326 species of butterflies have been recorded in the state of Arizona. The most ants in North America, 187 and counting, the most bee species on Earth, over 1,000. The Sky Islands region is listed by Conservation International and other organizations as one of the world's premier biodiversity hotspots. It's been identified by scientists as one of the top regions in the world most in need of protection for the survival of a myriad of species. One of the rarest commodities in the Sky Islands region is a flowing river. Here the Santa Cruz cuts its way through the San Rafael grasslands, supporting wildlife near and far. Perennial rivers travel the lowlands of the Sky Islands, affording many species of flora and fauna areas where they can flourish and locate critical resources. Various local animals and plants rely on such riparian zones for all or part of their life cycles. Thus, our few rivers support higher levels of biodiversity than most other Sky Islands habitats. By the time Sonora Creek nears the west end of Sonora Creek State Natural Area, something profound and disturbing has occurred. The water has completely disappeared. Riparian tree reproduction has gone down almost to nothing. The land looks wasted and spent. Is this a vision of the future for the natural area, for Sonora Creek, and for the Patagonia Mountains? It might well be, with profound changes coming to the area. The greatest threats to our flora and fauna are due to human activity, population growth, climate change, development, agriculture, and mining. Yes, we need housing, food, and mineral security. We also need security from rising levels of extinction. The first tenet of responsible mining should be a recognition that some places should not be mined, knowing the threats we face against our planetary ecosystems. One such place is the Patagonia Mountains. Currently, in the Patagonia Mountains, more than 100 species are classified as threatened, endangered, or sensitive. Species as diverse as Gila monster, brown vine snake, Mexican spotted owl, jaguar, Arizona sycamore, elegant trogon, canyon tree frog, western yellow-billed cuckoo, and many others depend upon the aquifer that underlies the heart of the Sky Islands. You may be wondering, why should I care about biodiversity? Why does it matter if plants and animals are endangered or go extinct? Species, including humans, do not exist in a vacuum. Biodiversity describes the number of species in any given area. The more biodiverse an area is, the more complex it is ecologically, and the more stable as well. Biodiversity is the very fabric of the natural world and the lives of various species intricately linked and interwoven with those of others. Every species, then, is a vital component of a healthy ecosystem. This is certainly the case in the Sky Islands, where so many species depend upon others for their very survival. If things get too far out of balance, the consequences can be devastating, not just for wildlife, but for us as well. We humans, in turn, rely upon thriving ecosystems for clean water, healthy air, recreation, and beauty. The vast majority of Sky Island ranges in Arizona are at great risk of mining now and into the future. Within the Madrean Archipelago, any national forest site, BLM, or other lands not officially designated as federal wilderness are completely at risk of disastrous mining operations. One mining company has filed documents with Arizona's Department of Environmental Quality seeking to discharge up to 6.5 million gallons of water a day from a water treatment plant into nearby Harshaw Creek. It's an alarming amount of water that has many wondering if the Patagonia Mountains can survive such a devastating blow. depletion of the aquifer will almost certainly harm or destroy numerous springs, seeps, and other surface water features at a time when these mountains are already under pressure from drought and climate change. Do we want the specter of mass environmental damage hanging over our unique sky islands? Patagonia Area Resource Alliance, or PARA, is a grassroots nonprofit community alliance founded 11 years ago by a handful of locals in Patagonia, Arizona. A strong and reasoned voice for protection of water and biodiversity in the Patagonia Mountains, PARA's mission is to protect the area's rich biodiversity from environmental damage introduced and inflicted by mining. PARA works closely with geologists, hydrologists, conservationists, traffic engineers, and other experts to ensure its efforts are based on data and sound science. The PARA watchdogs are a regular presence at local events, as well as state and local hearings related to water and mining, working tirelessly to educate the community about risks and realities of 21st century industrialized mining. Water is life. We shouldn't mine it away. At a time when Arizona is in a water crisis, can we afford to lose our precious groundwater? At a time when species are on the brink of extinction, can we afford to lose our priceless biodiversity? The extraordinary biodiversity in the Patagonia region supports a thriving ecotourism economy. The area is renowned locally and internationally by scientists, hikers, bird watchers, campers, hunters, mountain bikers, and other outdoor enthusiasts. Thus, the long-term health and economic prosperity of the community is tied to the well-being of the Patagonia Mountains and the Harshaw Creek-Sonorta Creek waterways. While mines may come and go, ecotourism is a vastly more sustainable enterprise. The very future of biodiversity in the heart of the Sky Islands is in our collective hands. Will we choose to protect it for generations to come?